This is Tuesdays with Ted. That's me. And I'm sharing with you everything that I know in hopes that you can elevate your life. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. How are we doing? It's Ted here. This is officially Tuesdays with Ted. And this is where I share with you everything I know. Basically, the idea is that I share with you all the tips and tricks that I've had, that I've learned over the course of my 46 lovely years that have helped me live a great life in hopes that some of that helps you. So today we're talking about what I call conscious endurance. What is conscious endurance? Well, probably a year and a half ago. Oh, and by the way, before I even get started too much into my whole spiel about conscious endurance, is if you have any questions along the way or any tips or tricks or anything that you feel like you want to add to this thing, it's really more of a conversation. It's more of a dialogue. It's something that I just kind of want to share with you, but please feel free to either ask questions or to have any input, whatever you want to do. Look at Adam Stern join. Look at, hey, Adam, how's it going? So anyway, we're talking about conscious endurance. What is conscious endurance? What does that mean to me? Where did it come from? So I had a discussion with a friend of mine a long time ago trying to figure out what I wanted to do when I grew up. And I'm still not grown up, and I don't ever plan to be grown up. But I did realize that a lot of my life really is the combination of a couple things. In fact, Adam was sweet enough, talking about Adam, to give me a birthday present that combined a few things that he felt I gave to him. So similarly, conscious endurance is a combination of a couple things that I have in my life that I want to essentially do forever and hopefully share with you guys. Adam made a comment that will not go public. No, he said weed, but I've never given him weed. I don't know where he gets his weed from, seriously. Anyway, so conscious endurance to me is one thing is about living consciously, and another thing is about endurance. For me, endurance is not enduring peace. That's right. That was another thing that he says I gave him was peace. So I appreciate that, Adam. And so endurance is not like enduring your toughest life. It's not trudging through life. Endurance is actually thriving and sort of crossing the finish line or feeling like you can live strong and healthy forever. And that's my thing. I think that nowadays with science, we're all going to live a little bit longer. So I think it was last week that I was talking about the Census Bureau, U.S. Census Bureau puts out their the aging population report. It's like a 200-page report that talks about statistics and where they get them from around the world. And one of the interesting things that I learned in that is they quantify something they call the quote-unquote healthy life expectancy. And a healthy life expectancy is different from the actual life expectancy. The healthy life expectancy begins at age 65. So they start like zero is 65. So assuming you're going to make it to 65, depending on which country you're going to live from, I think the highest life expectancy, full life expectancy, is 85, somewhere in the world, Singapore, I think. And again, this aging report came, I think, out in March of 2016. But it's not that much different now. But anyway, the healthy life expectancy is not to 85. The healthy life expectancy is to 75. It's basically half of that time above 65 that you're gonna be healthy. So I firmly believe that there are tools out there for all of us that we can use that can help us increase our healthy life expectancy. And I'm gonna stop using quotes because it's actually a real thing. So the healthy life expectancy, and how do we increase that? Well, I've come up with 10 different things. So again, feel free. Number one rank, Adam says number one rank is, Monaco is 89.5. Look at that. Adam must be on Google. Either that or he's so smart from from all his weed that he just can rip off these statistics on a regular basis. It's so funny. Merrick is asking, what would you say a good rule of thumb, in quotations, for knowing thriving versus something getting run into the ground? So I think the way I'm interpreting your question, Merrick, is, well, what it brings to mind is the definition of disabled. So someone is disabled if they cannot walk 100 meters or 100 yards by themselves without help. So think about that. For an older person, there's a bunch of different exercises you can do that will say whether or not you're disabled. One marker is essentially that, is to be able to walk 100 meters. So 100 meters is basically the length of a football field, including your end zones, almost. But otherwise, 100 yards sprint, you just have to walk that by yourself and not fall over and not need a cane. And if you can do that by yourself, you're not disabled. And oh, America's saying like a job. Oh, yeah, as far as a job or career thing, I'm not so sure about that. I think we're gonna have to continue to recreate that stuff on a regular basis. Actually, Adam can talk to us a little about investing, because that's what he did for a really long time. But anyway, back to conscious endurance and what it means to me. It's, I believe that it's living a conscious life for as long as you possibly can. Increasing that healthy life expectancy. I want to do what I do. I love yoga. I love running. I love biking. I love traveling. I love spending time with my family. I love, you know, being outdoors, and I love getting in the water and swimming, and I love doing all these things, and I want to do them until I'm 80, 90, 100 plus. I want to do them more. I want to do them until I'm 120 or 150 if it's going to be possible. If science is telling us that we're going to live longer, that we're going to be able to live this long, great life, I want that life to be as good as possible, quality-wise, right? I don't want to just be walking around in a walker for the last 30 years of my life. So how do we actually do that? So my, and I thought about this for a while, the first thing, so this is number one, there's 10 things that we're going to talk about in the next 20 minutes. And again, feel free to ask questions or add input anytime, and I'll pass it along to the group. But the first thing is attitude of gratitude. To me, you cannot live a happy, healthy, long life unless you're grateful. Grateful for what? Grateful for just about anything. So as far as I'm concerned, you wake up in the morning and you need to be grateful, because a lot of people don't wake up, right? There was just, if you're paying attention to the news, there was just a bombing last week that killed 200 civilians in Syria. Or no, I think it was in Mosul, actually. Was it in Mosul? Do you remember that? I don't know. So Jordan doesn't know. But anyway, they killed 200 civilians. So that's not going to happen, most likely, for most of us that are living in the U.S. At least, hopefully, we don't think so. But the point is that we could, there could be an earthquake. There could be some crazy, weird accident that happens. So be grateful for every single day. Have that gratitude. I think gratitude is a state of being. Make sure you have that on a regular basis. And it's all about training, too. So in a way, you have to kind of train yourself to be grateful, to let that be the place you go back to. So if you find yourself in this moment, and we all have moments where we're just shitty and it's just, we don't feel great, or we're stressed out, or we're tired, or we're jet lagged, or we're having an issue. And I mean, we all have situations like this. It's common for everyone. But the bottom line is we have to slowly but surely, and hopefully quicker over time, get back to that attitude of gratitude. So however you can get there, if you have that as your number one thing to do, that's one way that I found that helps me stay happy, right? Having that attitude of gratitude. And at the end of every day, depending on what religion you practice, you can hit your bed at night. Doesn't matter, by the way, but whatever it is for you, you hit your bed and you ask yourself, was I the best person that I could be today, right? And whether the answer is yes or no, just be grateful, because you had the opportunity to live. And then when you wake up, first thing, just go, hey, I'm awake now. Look at this. Fantastic. I have a new day to live, right? And Adam confirms, always. So number two is meditation. So meditation to me is a huge, huge, huge portion of our For me, it's a huge part of my thought process. It's a huge part of me being grateful. It's a huge part of what I love to do. And whether I just got back so today, I'm just finished a hike with a client and her two kids, and we went for a nice 2-hour hike, and then we did some yoga after. And it was a beautiful here in Malibu nowadays. It's beautiful. The sun is shining. The wildflowers are out. There's yellow everywhere and purples, and it's gorgeous. And whether you're out on a trail meditating or swimming and meditating, I swam for the first time in a couple months yesterday, and it just felt so good to get into the rhythm and just like let it be a little moving meditation. So when I say meditation, I don't necessarily mean you have to sit upright and meditate for 20 minutes a day. It doesn't need to be that way. Fear Fighter Fitness is asking if there's a specific kind of meditation I practice. Yeah, there is. I would call it mindfulness for, you know, lack of a more specific term. I've taken the 8-week mindfulness course, and there's a few different techniques I've learned over time. And actually, I can post it in the later. I can post it in the comments. But I created a 7-day meditation course, which starts off with 3 free videos about meditation and simply starting with the basics. So the basics are breathing. First thing, just relax and breathe. And that's the first thing I teach, is connecting with your breath, whether you're driving or whether you're standing in line. It's just like, take a nice big breath and just let that breath take a moment and calm you down. So there's a million different, not a million, but there's a lot of different times during the day that you can actually do that. It's just really training yourself to get there. And then hopefully that helps you relax a little bit. You drop your shoulders a little bit. You're not as stressed out. And then maybe that becomes a little bit more, and maybe it becomes, hey, you know what? I have to get to this appointment at 8 a.m. or whatever it is, 9 a.m., but I'm gonna show up 10 minutes early, and I'm just gonna pause for a moment, take a few breaths, right? Relax, let my mind that's spinning 50 to 70,000 thoughts a day, let that settle a little bit, and then go into the appointment, whatever that is. So my first thing, Fear Fighter Fitness, is to actually connect with the breath. And if that, once you can get beyond that, you can start to go from just taking a few breaths a few times a day to starting to carve out a couple minutes, 1 minute, and then 3 minutes, and then 5 minutes. And then you might find, actually, that you start to crave that. That's what happened to me. I remember the first time I started meditating, and I would always go home and I'd chill out and I'd turn on some cool music and I'd turn the lights on a dimmer and I'd just relax on my bed, and that was my form of meditation. But I always knew that there was this quote unquote real meditation. I was really meditating then. I was relaxing and I was getting the same benefits, but I felt like sitting in silence was the official way to meditate. So the first time I ever did it, it took me, so I said, okay, that's it, I'm gonna sit down and meditate. And I've told this story before, I set my timer for 10 minutes, and I set a candle. I sat up in a chair because I didn't want to be slunching and tired. So I sat up in a chair so my back had leaned back with my back straight, because the 3 kind of basic fundamentals for meditation: straight spine, even breath, and a single pointed focus. So I did that, closed my eyes, and then after probably 30 seconds, I started freaking out. I was like, there's no way I'm gonna make it 10 minutes. It's not gonna happen. And my shoulders started tightening up, my fists started tightening up, my jaw was tightening up. It was like this fight back and forth in my mind. It was crazy town. And then finally I was like, all right, that's it, I'm opening my eyes. And it was 9 minutes and 43 seconds. And I'll always remember that number because I didn't make it to 10 minutes. But what happened was it unlocked the door for me to want to go back and sit still. And that was a huge thing. So the fact that I suffered for 9 minutes and 43 seconds actually led me to a time and place in my life where I started craving the silence. I would do exactly what I just said, which was arrive. I would go a half an hour early and I'd go sit someplace. I'd sit on a park bench and I would just relax. I'd close my eyes and I'd just sit, listen to the breeze and listen to the birds and people walking by, and it was so fulfilling for me. So a simple meditation like that is something that you can do. But I would say the biggest thing for meditation and starting a meditation practice is really just not making meditation a big deal. Just whatever you can do, if you can just connect with your breath a few times a day, that's the beginning. And then let it grow. You know, plant the seed and let it grow. Try to do that on a regular basis. And then let that breath a few times a day grow. So our third thing in conscious endurance is mindset. So mindset relates right closely to meditation, because mindset is really kind of what we're thinking. So meditation, you sort of observe what you're thinking. That's another form of meditation. You're welcome. As another form of meditation is to observe what you're thinking. It's a Vipassana style of meditation where you have a thought, you acknowledge the thought, you let the thought pass through your mind. It's something, one of the things I talk about in my course, but the mindset is really important. So if you're an exercise person, you know that you perform way better when you exercise and you're like, your mind is ready and you're gonna go kick somebody's tail or whatever it is. You're gonna go lift a weight or go run or bike or do whatever you're gonna do. You know that if your mind is actually in sync with what you're gonna do, it's way easier than if your mind is not. You're just like, oh, I don't wanna get out of bed and this is horrible and just give me my coffee and I'm gonna hit the snooze button, right? Like all that stuff comes from your mind. So it's really important to understand how your mind works and the mind patterns, because once you understand them, then you'll actually be able to shift your mindset. So like I'm sitting here talking about this because I sort of constructed this whole little idea and 10 steps to what I believe gives us a long, healthy, active life. And so it's what I'm thinking about. It's what I think about on a regular basis. And how can I do that for myself, do that for my family, and help others do the same thing? But I didn't always think about this, right? I wasn't born this way, right? I used to think about partying my ass off and smoking a whole bunch of weed with Adam. No, too bad, Adam. Those days are over for me, man. I don't do that anymore. But anyway, the point is that I wasn't always thinking this way, and I was able to change my mind. I was able to shift my mindset. And that's why it's number three in the 10 steps of conscious endurance, is understanding your mindset and then using it to your benefit. So there's a lot of different ways to do that. The main thing, and as I know it sounds simple, but the main thing is choose it. Just choose to be more positive. Choose to believe in yourself. And I know, and it's really tricky, because a lot of that is that critical mind that happens, like, we're not good enough, we're never gonna be able to do this, and blah, 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 blah. So you really have to fight against that. But there does come a point, and when you've won that battle, when you've won that fight, that's the mind, the positivity in the mind, and the encouraging mind actually begins to be much more common than the negative part. So with your mindset, a couple little tips and tricks to do for that is, one thing is, when you have the negative thinking, just recognize it. You have to recognize it first. Once you recognize it, you go, oh, wait a second, that's Mr. Negative or Mrs. Negative, and I'm not gonna buy in to that bull crap anymore. I am going to suck it up and I'm gonna move forward and push against it, right? So, hey Juan, what's going on, my man? Juan joined. Juan, maybe he's in Vegas. I know he's from Vegas, we'll see. Fighting against so much emotional crap we've been fed through various channels throughout our lives. Dave, yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, it's like swimming upstream, right? To have a positive mindset and always to have that encouraging sense inside you. Think of it as an inner coach. But we're not born with an inner coach. We get that from somewhere. Right? I look at my little girl, she's 13 months old, and we're just trying to encourage her more and more and more. Hopefully encourage her to believe that she can do stuff. But I wasn't brought up that way. I don't know about you guys, but that wasn't the case for me. So you're swimming upstream if you wanna live this way. If you wanna have a long, healthy life and active and increase that healthy lifespan and live with conscious endurance, then you have to swim upstream. All right. So our fourth one is exercise. Everybody knows that we got to exercise. This is not a thing, right? I use the mindset. I use exercise as an example in the mindset category because it's usually the one that's most common for everybody. Everybody knows, ugh, I don't want to go exercise. I don't want to go deal with this. I don't want to, do these things or whatever it is. I don't want to confront this person. And so that's your mindset comes in. But with exercise, it's got to be non-negotiable. You can't, it's interesting because there was another article that I just saw over the weekend in the New York Times. Gretchen Reynolds, I love her. She's an incredible writer. She writes a column in the New York Times, a wellness column in the New York Times, and she also wrote a book called The First 20 Minutes, because there's so much science now in exercise that tells you that the biggest benefits you get in exercise happen in the first 20 minutes. And she's great. She finds all these different studies and that happening at different research centers around the world, and she just kind of breaks them down and makes them easily digestible. And the one she talked about was about aging muscles. And they did a group with 19 participants, I think. It was 19 in each group. They had one group group that was under 30 or 30 and under, and they had another group that was over, did you read this article, Jordan? They had another group that was over 62 or 65, I forget. And then they had a control group that didn't exercise. So the people who were under, they had them lift weights and they did a whole weight training thing. And then they had, obviously, the older group lift weights too. But then they did high intensity interval training at the younger age and high intensity interval training at the older age. And what they found was a certain amount of genes are kind of expressed, right? These genes turn on. And the difference was, it was like 33 genes turned on for the people who are lifting weights, 33, I think, for the older folks, and like 19 for the younger folks if they were lifting weights. But when they did the high intensity interval training, it was like 170 or so, I forget the actual numbers, but it was a low, like 200 maybe for the younger generation, and like 400 for the people over 62 or whatever it was. It was unbelievable. I'll actually put a link. I did post it on my fan page. So if you scroll down a few, I think I shared it. I for sure shared it on Twitter. But I can post it again in the comments. So anyway, what it shows is that it doesn't matter how old you are, but that exercise, more specifically in this article, in this research study, it was high intensity interval training that actually had the most benefit. But we all know exercise is important. It's one of the most important things you can do. So it was Brendan Brazier, actually, who's a friend, and he's the guy who created Vega. And he talked about at one point, we did a retreat a while back, and he was just saying how when your body's sore, it's in a state of regeneration, of growth. And I love that, because if you're sore, your body's rebuilding itself, which is exactly what happens when you grow. So why not continue that state of regeneration and growth on a regular basis? Now that leads me to number five, which is recovery and yoga. So recovery and yoga is so important because we need self-care. We need to be able to take care of ourselves in this way. So if you're going to live healthy and you're going to live a long life, and your healthy life expectancy is going to increase beyond 50% after 65, for those of you that tuned in late, the whole idea here is conscious endurance, and it's about living a healthy, active, happy life forever. 80, 90, 100, 110, 120, however long you live, I want that your healthy life expectancy, not just life expectancy. And it's different, right? It's different. So what I want is for everybody to be active and healthy and alert. That's another big one. So recovery in yoga is important. It's important to exercise. It's also important to recover. It's important to do yoga, to stretch your muscles. You want to keep mobility. If you don't, we tighten up. You can see it. People look at the old lady pushing the shopping cart, right? The old man has got the big hunchback. It's crazy. It's unnecessary. So, of course, my two things are simply yoga. I mean, I love yoga and recovery. When I say recovery in yoga, what I mean is foam rolling, using a ball, getting those stretches out, yin yoga, regular vinyasa flow yoga. So whatever you need to do We got a couple comments here. Oh, you just finished a 3-week yoga retreat. All right, excellent. Do you see the 98-year-old lady doing yoga and teaching yoga? I did see that, actually. Who's that? The original Samantha VDW, it looks like. Yeah, I did see that, Samantha, and it's awesome. I've seen her a couple things before. And by the way, there's a guy who owns the record of the fastest mile. He did it on a track, on a bike, for the age group of 105 plus. He's French. But there's also a guy from Canada who has the world record of the fastest marathon for anyone above 85. Like, these are the people that I wanna beat. I wanna take them down. I have 40 years or 60 years to get there. But anyway, the point is that people are out there doing this stuff now, right? And those of you that are Beachbody fans or P90X fans, you know my buddy Tony, who is like Mr. Friggin', you know, anomaly. The guy's 58 years old and he's doing 50 pull-ups. That's not the norm, right? Or Mark Sisson, who's a local neighbor here, and the guy's in his 60s and just ripped and killing it and playing ultimate frisbee on every weekend and like a real competitor. So these things are possible. I just learned about a book, and this is going really later than normally. We're 30 minutes, so we might have to do part two. Either that, I'll give you the last five, but then next week we'll do part two, and I'll give you a little bit more things. But anyway, so the book that I just learned about is by a woman named Katie Bowman. So Katie Bowman wrote Move Your DNA. We found her through my friend Jill Miller. Jill is an old friend who actually married another old friend of mine, and they have Yoga Tune-Up. So Yoga Tune-Up is a huge company and business, and she has a whole plan and theory and workshops on using these balls to help you stay healthy. And that's, you know, your yoga practice and these balls, right? Trigger point therapy. But Katie Bowman wrote a new book called Dynamic Aging. And Dynamic Aging, she co-wrote this with three or four co-authors, all in their 70s, I think 70s. But there's a story of one woman who started taking classes with Katie Bowman, who's 71. She's now 79, and she's climbing trees, and she's hanging on a regular basis. That's a big deal, so you can elongate and have some traction for your spine. So I am 46, and do I need to be thinking about what a 71-year-old is doing? Absolutely, because I want to get there, and I want to already be not where she was when she was 70, just getting into that class, right? She's just getting there and going, oh, I need to train myself to learn how to use a cane at 70. I want to be climbing friggin' Kilimanjaro when I'm 70. So that's the shift, right? That's the shift in the mindset, and that's the shift. And so the recovery portion, people like Katie Bowman, people like Jill Miller, people like Kelly Starrett at Mobility Wad, these are all people that I look to learn from to actually help in the recovery portion. So that's number five in our conscious endurance. There are 10, but since these only go 30 minutes, I'm gonna keep it to 30 minutes. And what I'm gonna do is tell you the next six, and then we'll go through them deeper next week. So the next six are nutrition, time together. Time together is love, connection, giving it away or service is another big one. Time with nature is huge. So just having this quick conversation with this client up in the mountains, she's from New York. And my whole thing is, of course, I love New York City. I was there. I love the energy. I love the people. It's fantastic. But guess what? I don't get to spend nearly as much time with greenery as I do when I'm here. And that's one of the reasons why I'm not moving back. I might move back upstate New York or something. Who knows what, you know, where life is going to take me, but it's going to be somewhere in nature. That much I can tell you. And then finally is sleep. So number 10 is sleep. But again, like I said, you guys, we got attitude of gratitude, meditation, mindset, exercise, recovery, and yoga. We've covered those, the other five, and then a bonus one that we'll talk about next time. So thank you so much for tuning in, you guys. And thank you for all your support. And, oh geez, we got a whole bunch of hair. She was amazing. goals. Yes. That pegboard. Oh, God. All right, you guys. Thanks so much. I'll see you next week. Bye.